Hello, bonjour, and welcome to Perfect Harmony, music of the Fête Galante, the opening concert in the Anchorage Festival of Music's 66th season. I'm Corrine McVie, board president of the Anchorage Festival of Music. What you're about to see is a recording of our first live in-person concert in almost 2 years. The name of this concert, Perfect Harmony, refers to the beautiful and uplifting music of the French Baroque. Perfect Harmony also refers to this incredibly rare chance to see and hear two double manual harpsichords being played at the same time. With your help, the AFM will continue to create innovative, intimate, and informative musical experiences. We hope you will consider making a donation today, just as you would have purchased a ticket to a live performance. It's easy. Visit AnchorageFestivalOfMusic.org and click on Give. Now sit back, relax, and enjoy some perfect harmony.
Watteau, by nature bestowed with inspirational talent, received her gifts very gratefully. Never has another hand painted her so beautifully, nor known how to portray her with themes so gallant. To be gallant in style and manner was the epitome of culture for the French aristocracy of the early 18th century. A gallant person was honest, civil, and sociable, a good companion and conversationalist who ensured the topics were light and pleasant, nothing intense or overly philosophical. The works of Watteau, his students, and colleagues embrace life's simple pleasures. Elegantly dressed subjects partake in leisurely strolls, picnics, or other recreational activities, all celebrating gallantry of character and deportment, a fête galante. Such scenes often occur in idealized country settings, featuring characters of the Italian commedia dell'arte. Figures literally harmonize with nature through music and dance. The fête galante translated into music with similar themes of nature, country dances, and Italian fashion. Composers sought to quell the long-standing feud between French and Italian musical style. Indeed, this is the very narrative of François Couperin's apotheosis, honoring the great giant of French Baroque music, Jean-Baptiste Lully. Apollo persuades Lully and his Italian counterpart, Arcangelo Corelli, to harmonize in the afterlife. Couperin assigns the two treble parts to Lully and Corelli. These are performed by the flute and violin in this performance of the work's closing trio sonata. As Lully and Corelli work together, Couperin envisions the ensuing peace of Parnassus, home of the muses and musical perfection itself.
La Bergère by Montclair is a sweet cantata that tells the story of a shepherdess who is speaking to her flock as she leads them down a new path, trying to avoid seeing the man who broke her heart. She bemoans that love is always torture, and really it would be better to only have friends who are dogs and sheep. In the final aria, she's trying to surrender herself to death and to her heartbreak, but the pesky birds overhead keep interrupting. Thank you.
pleasure this last week, not only to play one harpsichord, but to have a second harpsichord player to work with. Normally a harpsichord player is used to playing with a lot of other instruments, but not another harpsichordist, because the act of getting two harpsichords together is quite something. One harpsichord is already a lot, two harpsichords, it more than doubles the effort. But not only that, I've also had the pleasure of working with both of these instruments and getting them into a good playing order. Harpsichords, unfortunately, don't really look after themselves very well. They do need constant care. If you ignore them for too long, all sorts of little things start going wrong inside. Each of these harpsichords, they're actually very similar instruments. They're based on the same model, which is an instrument made by a Frenchman, Pascal Tascan, in 1769. So a very late instrument. Already from the time when it was clear that the piano was going to be the winner in the battle of, is it going to be the harpsichord or the piano that propels music into the 19th century. But the harpsichord did a valiant set of efforts to try to remain competitive, and these beautiful instruments are the end of that glorious line. These instruments both have two keyboards, rather like the two manuals of an organ, and three sets of strings. When you're getting a harpsichord to work, you have to adjust each of the three plucks for every note. So I'm thinking that the total between these two instruments is about 370 plucks to adjust. It's not only the intensity of the pluck, it's also the timing between the plucks. These are all very important things, so that the instrument not only sounds right, but it also feels right. And it is, for me, one of the great joys to work on beautiful instruments like these. So you won't hear the second harpsichord until the second half, but you will hear the harpsichord that I'm playing, the festival instrument here, now being used in this half in a continuo role. The piece that we're about to play for two cellos and continuo is actually written out on three lines, could be played by three cellos. We've chosen to do it today with two cellos playing the solo lines. I'm playing the accompanying line. And you may wonder where all my right-hand notes come from. They are all made up in the moment or worked out during rehearsal. So there's a lot of improvisation going on in harpsichord parts, and that's another one of the great joys of playing harpsichord in ensemble. As you may see, my tie has a bass clef. People often ask me, why do you have a bass clef? It's because the harpsichord can really be considered as part of the bass section of the orchestra. It's always a great joy to work with really fine cellists playing bass lines, because my left hand will be playing the same notes, so we have a very important coupling. And it's even more fun to work with two bass instruments, so again, one of the great joys for me.
Thank you.
Jean-Marie Leclerc chose the musically unusual title of Recreations to bind his collections of light and easy-to-perform character pieces and dances. The forlan is similar to the gigue in meter and lively style. It originated as a Venetian street dance and retained an association with frivolity and flirtation. Thank you.
next cantata by Rameau is typical of French cantatas from this time in that the action and the plot are brought forth in the recitative, while the arias are reserved to express emotion. This cantata also demonstrates a practice that Rameau used throughout his life masterfully of sudden harmonic shifts to express sudden dramatic shifts in the text. The story of this cantata is taken from mythology, and it follows the story of a young shepherd, very faithful shepherd, who is offering himself in sacrifice for his beloved Amaryllis, who has been wrongfully accused of infidelity and sentenced to death by the gods. The first recitative and aria tell of his despair and desperation to save her, while the second recitative, he offers himself in her place. And the aria that follows praises the depth of his selflessness and willingness to sacrifice himself for her. In the third recitative and aria, the gods are appeased by his act and all live happily ever after.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm sure you've been wondering about, if not waiting for, what's that other harpsichord doing there? So in a minute I'm going to play it. In fact, we're going to play a piece for two harpsichords. This is not so different from a piece for one harpsichord. If you're playing your own part, you might think, oh, this is a pretty complete piece of music already, just with one part going. When you put the two parts together, you'll be amazed. This is an early experiment in surround sound, because I challenge you to be able to determine where the sounds are coming from exactly. I think you'll get the impression that the sounds are coming from everywhere in the room. And if you challenge yourself to try and figure out who's playing which notes, you'll find it very difficult. These are two very well-matched harpsichords based on the same model, and I voiced them as much as I could so that they are extremely compatible. They both play at the same level and each has a distinct flavor, but it's pretty subtle, the difference between the instruments. So before we play the allemande, I'm going to play a little bit of the beginning of it on my own, and then Susan will play a little bit of her part on her own, and you'll see immediately that the parts are not connected. They are completely independent lines, which is unusual. Often when there are pieces for two harpsichords, there's a common bass line that we both play, and we play different parts in the right hand. But in this piece, the richness is achieved because each of us has an entirely independent part. After we play the allemande, we'll wait a little bit while chairs are brought out, and I won't tell you why chairs are being brought out. You'll figure that out as we go through. But there'll be a change of character, and you will hear the harpsichord in some senses being demoted from its glorious status as the most regal of all the instruments to slumming it and going and playing musette music. And musette is kind of like a bagpipe. So we're going to make these regal instruments sound like folk instruments playing an outdoor concert. So in case you're wondering, this is me.
Thank you for celebrating the music of the Fête Galante with us. Please join our email list and follow us on social media to find out about future Anchorage Festival of Music events. Please also consider a financial donation to help us produce future informative and innovative concerts. Our final piece comes from Rameau's Castor et Pollux, the story of two brothers vying for the affection of the same woman. In this aria, beautifully arranged by Victoria Fraser, the young woman is expressing her grief at the death of Castor. What she doesn't yet know is that Pollux will take his brother's place in the underworld, and Jupiter will be so moved by the selfless act that he will grant them all immortality in the sky. The story expresses the utopian ideals of the Fête Galante.